Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110. Now, here's this week's message. The alarm clock hits. It's time for work. 9 to 5. 9 to 5, and sometimes longer. The same routine, the same people, day in and day out, Monday through Friday. And on Sunday night, the Monday blues kick in. But what if there was something more to my work? What if I was there for a purpose? Jesus tells us that we are a light to the world. If I'm a light, then I shouldn't hide it, but display it. My work isn't just a place to make a paycheck, but a place to live out the purpose of God. What if we live each day with a purpose? Work wouldn't just be work, but redefined to be exactly where God wants us to be, for purposes that are beyond what we could dream of.
Good morning, how are you? We are starting a new series on work. So I want to start out with a question. How many of you have ever had a job that you didn't like? Let me see. Okay. We have a lot in common, right? Maybe that's the job you still have. I don't know. We'll be addressing those kinds of things. But, you know, it's interesting that studies talk a lot about the impact of work in our lives. Came across a few researchers show at the University of Aberdeen that the single most important factor in life satisfaction and overall well-being was your satisfaction at your job. It impacted more than how you felt about your family, your leisure time, your health, your finances, your social life. The biggest predictor in life satisfaction was your work. Gallup study in 2013, over 250,000 people found that 30% of employees are engaged. 70% feel like they're not engaged. They're just going through the mechanics because they're so unfulfilled. 70%. What's more, there's been a dramatic increase in stress-related illnesses for people who have high-speed jobs with tight deadlines, which seems like that's most of the jobs nowadays. People who are happy in their work tend to be happy in their lives. People who are miserable at work tend to be miserable in their lives. In fact, one study cited by a guy named John Maxwell said that outside of genetics, that job satisfaction was the number one predictor of how long you will live. Now that you heard this, how many of you are thinking, I don't know if I'll live another moment? Our jobs. They play such an important role in our lives. And when we look at the Bible and we look at what God has to say, He has a lot to say about work, actually. And somehow connecting what happens on Sunday morning to what happens on Monday morning would be the goal of these three-week series. That I've talked to people. I've talked to some of you in our church, and I'll say, you know, tell me about how you implement your faith at work. And many times I hear, I don't know how. I don't see the connection. So we're going to talk about that over this 3 weeks, how to make that connection so that it's not just two different experiences. And it really begins, a lot of it, as you look in the Bible, a lot of it is our attitude. So we're going to look at 7 attitude changes in our attitude about work, that if we implement this, it will impact our work and our lives. Number one, thank God for work. Not just thank God that you have a job. There's certainly do that. But thank God for work. Thank God for Monday that work is available, that He created this idea of work, that you get to work. See, God invented work. We see this in Genesis. It says, by the seventh day, God had finished the work that He had been doing. On the seventh day, He rested from all of His work. So the very first person working in the Bible is God. And then we see in the beginning, God created, meaning that God's at work. He's a living God who works. Why this is unique is because in the ancient world, gods didn't work. They didn't work. You know, Zeus, he didn't work. See, in the idea in the ancient world, Greek world, and other religions, is they had these so-called gods, and people were there to feed them so they could like party and rest and do their leisurely things and do the things they wanted to do. And they weren't working. So Moloch, he was a god in the ancient world, did not work. Baal, he was a god, didn't work. But see, Yahweh, the God of Israel, he worked. So that made him stand out. There was something different with Yahweh, God who was working. One implication of this is one scholar put it this way. He said, Israel was virtually the only ancient people who viewed work as dignifying rather than demeaning. See, because God works, it's something of dignity. In the ancient world, tradespeople were slaves. There were cities that they would say it was ill. They would pass law saying is you couldn't work unless you were a slave, a woman, or somebody from outside, you know, an alien. Other than that, they because work was like below them. But we don't see that in the Bible. We see that work, having a trade, was a good thing. In fact, in some of the Hebrew writings, the Talmud, it says this: he who does not teach his son a trade is as if he teaches him robbery. So passing on a trade, that's a good thing. It's a good thing to have a trade. And we see this in the Bible. Peter, he was a fisherman. That was a trade. And then the Apostle Paul, he wrote a big part of the New Testament. He was a tent maker. That's what he did. He made tents. Jesus was a carpenter. Folks, this was not by accident. This was by design. God thinks working is valuable. He himself works. And so it changes our mindset when we can thank God for work. We go, wow, it's something that a way I express myself, the way I express who I am. What is work? Work is the expenditure of energy to create value. The expenditure of energy. And another way to say it is work is love made visible. It's a way that we're able to care for somebody, to add value to somebody. And it makes the world a better place because we work. So work is a good thing. So regardless of what you do, and there's all kinds of work. It's all kinds of work. I mean, you could be a student in your work. You could be an at-home mom, you work. You can be unemployed and you're still working. Hopefully part of your work is putting in applications. That's a form of work. So whatever we do when we work, we can thank God for that. We can say, God, I thank God for Mondays. So sometimes attitude makes a difference. So number two, crush it as unto the Lord, okay? Crush it, because that's a good thing. I'm not sure you want that on your resume, but it is a good thing to crush. Paul writes to the Christians at Colossae, he says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart. It's talking about crushing it, right? Work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters. And so you give it your all. And you give it as though you're working for the Lord. And if you just read that verse alone, you think, well, maybe that's a metaphor. You're kind of like working for God. But as you really read the Bible, you find out that, no, you're actually working for the Lord. In Genesis, it says, the Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. You see, God gave us, humankind, he gave us dominion. Dominion means he gave us He gave us work to do. He gave us an assignment. He's given us a mission. And it involves creating culture, and it involves creation care. And those two things, they're all encompassing kind of the big picture for our assignment. And he gave us resources. He gave us a place to do it. He gave us oversight. There's accountability. This is our work. And we're supposed to, we actually, when we work, we're working for God. Our assignments look differently, but they all include those things. And when you literally work for Jesus, it really does change your attitude. I mean, the way you approach your work, no matter what you do, you're gonna give it more gusto. You're gonna crush it harder. You're gonna have more self-initiative. You're going to have more accountability, personal accountability, of honesty and integrity. You're gonna bring your best creative skills. You're gonna bring your best, and that's what this second attitude is so important. So often we don't want to be part of that 70% that's disengaged, that we're fully engaged. How do I crush it? Number three, remember the easy yoke. Remember the easy yoke. You go, what does that mean? Well, Jesus talks about it. And he uses, interesting, yoke is from a work, it's an illustration from work, from agriculture. Jesus often uses illustrations and examples from the world of work. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, which is a lot of people these days, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke, there it is, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So a yoke, so the easy yoke, not a yoke over easy, that's an egg. This is a yoke. And a yoke, as I said, is this idea from agriculture, and it's on an ox. Now, when you have oxen in a yoke, how many oxen do you have? How many? Two, exactly. You have two. And what it means is you never work alone. You never work alone is what Jesus is saying. He's saying, always have me at your side. God wants to work. He wants to actually come alongside. And he says, this is what happens when you're burdened, when you're weary. It means you're working alone. You see, work is not what kills us. It's all the stress. It's the environment. It's when we're doing it all alone and we get swallowed up in that. But he says, you don't have to be like that. Let me come alongside and yoke up with you. And it's this apparatus that would go and allow two oxen to work together. And so you work with God. God wants to be there with you. He wants to help you. Dallas Willard says it like this. He says, let's say I'm a plumber going to clean out somebody's sewer. You stay attentive to what you're doing at the moment. You ask, how will I do this as Jesus would do this? As if Jesus was the plumber. He says, if you encounter difficulties with people you're serving or with a pipe, you never fight that battle alone. You invoke the presence of God. You expect to see something happen that is not the result of you. The crucial thing is to be attentive to God's hand, not to get locked into thinking, it's me and this pipe. Never do that. And so that's what happens sometimes is when work comes at us, it's challenging, it's difficult. We start to think, it's just me and this pipe. It's me and this angry customer. It's me and this computer that's too slow. It's me and we just get kind of perseverating in that. It's just me. And Jesus says, no, take my yoke upon you. He goes, I want to be part of that. I want to be part of your life, not just at church, not just at home, but in the workplace. In the workplace. Do you know what this is? This is a game controller, but it's a guitar from Guitar Hero. I don't know if you've played this. This is a fun game. I'm not that good at it. I'm not going to play it now. But I'm going to explain how this game works. This came out in 2005. And the goal is, it's kind of like air guitar, but you have five buttons that represent the five strings on a guitar. And then when you're playing on the screen, as the buttons, there's kind of something similar to this, and you're trying to match the colors and syncopate, and there's classic rock songs, and you're playing along to it, and you try to get points, and you try, and if you do well, there's like a virtual crowd that's going, yeah! and it's fun, right? So I played with my kids. They were way better than me. And for them, for me, it was more like work. You know, which is not a bad thing. I like work. But it just meant at the end of one song, like they were, okay, let's play another song. I need a concentration break now, you know. I mean, This is challenging, but it's still fun. My favorite part, though, and this is where I'm going with this. My favorite part of this game was something called star power. Star power, they had this little counter in the bottom corner of the screen, and as you played, you kind of racked up these points, the star power points, and it'd get to 50%, then 75%, and at 100%, you could just, all you had to do is lift your guitar up, and you like were catapulted into this amazing rock star, which I was like sucked before. Now all of a sudden, and the crowd's going wild, and I'm doing amazing, and then there's like these multiplying points. My points are going up by four times as much, and I'm in the zone, right? Star power, yeah. Jesus is like star power. You're doing your own thing. You're working. You're trying to make it work. You're concentrating. You're working hard. And when you call on his name and you invoke Jesus, Jesus, I need your help here. I'm not going to just do this by myself. I need some star power. And then you see God comes in and helps you out. It's in a way, it's that easy. But so often we just get tunnel vision. We're Christ followers and we think we can do it all on our own. We think we're supposed to do it all on our own. Maybe that's our penance or something. That is not God's plan for us. He says, call on his name. Invoke his presence. Look for God to come alongside you and help you, and he will. And then he multiplies our efforts. Okay? Number four. Fourth attitude. Stop being so defensive. It's so easy to get defensive. We get defensive about everything. Somebody says something about our work, we get defensive. Somebody says something about our attitude, we get defensive. Somebody says something about our how fast we're working, we get defensive. Whatever it is. And so if an attitude to change the whole experience at work is to just let down your defenses, let your dukes down. Just say, I'm not gonna walk around like this. Don't you say anything about me, boy. You know? Who do you think you are? Proverbs says, too much pride causes trouble. Be sensible and take advice. You see, we as Christ followers get it. We understand our value before God. God loved us so much that he sent his only son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. That he entrusts us with the kingdom. And he says that he gives, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. And he talks about what we're going to inherit in heaven. I mean, he says this, we are adopted into his family. I mean, that when you start to really get that, you realize, wow, I feel pretty good about myself. And so Christ followers should be the most teachable. We should be the most coachable. Which means when somebody says something that could be beneficial for us, we should be open to that, right? And it doesn't, everybody's broken, so I mean, it doesn't come perfectly. Our goal is to sort through it and say, okay, there's probably something I can learn from that. Proverbs 15:32, whoever ignores instruction despises himself, but he who listens to reproof gains intelligence. So circle those words, listens and intelligence, because they go together. You see, when we get defensive, we stop listening. We kind of shut down. We go into this shutdown mode. I'm not interested in hearing what you have to say. And listening is different than hearing. You can hear somebody. That's what most of us do. We think we're listening, but we're just hearing them. We're hearing their words. Really what's going on is in our mind, we're formulating what we're going to say, because that's all that really matters. We don't really care what they have to say. What we say, that's matter. So okay, are you almost done? Because when you're done, I've got what I'm thinking. Listening means you don't do that. You don't have that private conversation going on. Listening means you say, okay, I'm just listening to you. I just want to hear what you have to say. And so what that might look like is somebody who you haven't always got along well with, maybe at work or something, you say, hey, can we talk for a little? Can I get you a cup of coffee or maybe have lunch? And you sit down and you say, you know what? I am not always easy to get along with. I understand that. But that's an area I want to grow. But I can't always see it. I have blind spots. I would like to know from your perspective what it's like working with me. Would you share with me? Be honest. You know, and then you just take notes. You don't try to excuse yourself. You don't try to rationalize. You don't try to change this. You don't try to solve the situation. You just write it down, and you're just engaged in that, and you just listen. That's what listening is. And when you have that attitude, it transforms your workplace. Number five. So we have thank God for work. Crush it as unto the Lord. Remember the easy yoke. Stop being defensive. Don't compare your career advancement with others. Proverbs again, a heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. Work is the place that can cause envy. People looking at each other. Vineyard is a newer movement, and in professional ministry, envy happens there as well. The Vineyard movement's about 35 years old, pretty young movement for a church movement. We have about 700 churches in the U.S. and then almost 1,000 outside of the U.S. So what that means is that all these churches have started in the last 35 years or less, which means that those who are leading those churches, those pastors, most of them are the ones that started the church. And so when we get together in groups and we have conferences and we have a smaller breakout things and we do, get together. And sometimes you'll see this dark side come out where somebody will be going, oh, yeah, well, how big is your church? And the churches range, from 35 people to, 3,500 people or bigger and all in between. And they go, how big is, your church? And when they tell them if it's bigger, they're often okay with that if that person's older than them and they've been doing it longer. But if they're younger, if they go, yeah, I've only been doing this 2 years and my churches are, and it's double their size, then they don't do well. They're getting all bent out of shape because they're thinking, I want what you have. Now, let me ask you, have you ever wanted somebody else's job? Okay, so if you've ever wanted somebody else's salary, somebody else's job, somebody else's office, somebody else's position, their career path, raise your hand. Let me see. Ever? Yeah. So that's part of our condition, right? Our human condition, this envy thing. Well, the Bible says stop it. Now it's easier said than done, right? Because it's so deep in there. It's like hardwired into us. And so that's a battle that we'll probably be fighting for a long time. Here's one thing that might help, okay? Pray for that person. Think of the person you're most envious of and pray that God blesses them even more. Say, Lord, just give them even more. And that'll be hard, as you could expect. But what will happen is it's hard to be envious and pray for their blessing that God gives them even more at the same time. So that can start to erode that envy. Certainly in that moment, you might have a reprieve of envy, when you're praying for them. An honest prayer, a sincere prayer. But you got to be careful that you don't fall into that. 2 Corinthians, they are foolish who compare themselves to themselves. He says, see, when we compare, we're dead either way. Because if you think you're better than them, then you get filled with pride. If you think they're better than you and they're doing better than you, then you get discouraged. So you don't win in that deal. You just don't, and it's false comparisons anyways, because everybody has unique situations going on. People are gifted differently. People have different time constraints. People have different energy resources. People have different responsibilities. Somebody might be like in the pastoral realm, somebody's church might be bigger, but they're neglecting their personal devotions. They don't spend any time with the Lord. And that's possible. You can grow a church and not spend time with God. So are they successful? So, I mean, you just can't even compare like that. You don't know what's going on in their life. You're just responsible for yourself. So you don't get into the comparison and the envy thing. Number six, expect problems. Expect problems. It's interesting that we go to work and sometimes we're surprised when it's so tough. I don't want a job. I want a job that's easier. Well, work is called work because it's hard, right? I mean, it's inherently hard. And it's part, God gave us work to do. Now, it is harder than it was originally created to be. God gave us work, but sin entered the world and that caused us to have harder work. So that's true. But sometimes people think that work was like part of the curse. Like, and then once you get to heaven, all work's off. I'm done. I float on a cloud or something and take an eternal vacation. But that's not how it works. The truth is, God gave us work before the fall, and when sin came in, it messed things up. It did make things harder. It says, now the ground will produce thorns and thistles for you, and by the sweat of your brow you will eat. It's harder now. It's harder now. We are alienated from our work, as Karl Marx said. It's more difficult. There's greater levels of stress and dysfunction and problems in communication and all kinds of things that enter into the workplace. Here's a great picture of that Jesus gives. It's a picture about, he's talking about discipleship, but he pulls from the world of work, and it certainly applies to work. He says, no one who puts their hand to the plow and then keeps looking back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Again, he's talking about being a disciple. He says, hey, when you sign up to be a Christ follower, you go all in. But as a metaphor, it applies to work. He says, you got a plow, right? Why do you have a plow? Because the ground is hard. If the ground wasn't hard, you wouldn't need the plow. And you start plowing, and it's hard work. And you go, well, that's like you're describing my job. You know, it's just hard work, you know, hard ground. Yeah. So if Jesus had your job, if Jesus had the plow, would he just go about 5 feet and go, this is too hard, I'm giving up? No, I mean, he's gonna keep plowing away, right? He says, don't even look back. Just keep plowing, focus. It's going to be difficult, but we persevere, and you keep working hard. Sometimes problems, actually, if we're looking for problems, there's plenty of problems around, right? If we're looking to be problem solvers, we'll never be unemployed. There's plenty of problems. And if we're, say, hey, help me to be, you pray, you ask God, give me the resource, the ability to be a problem solver, you can impact a lot of people. I want you to hear the story of a member of our church, Dara Ye. She had a job that has lots and lots. Her job changed a little bit. She'll explain that. But she had lots and lots of problems. She describes a little bit how she asked God to help her through this process of solving problems. She expected them and she solved them. Watch this.
Hi, my name is Dara Ye. My husband Robert and I have been worshiping here at the Vineyard for about 14 years. And that's about the same amount of time that I've been working for a local telecommunications company in the area after my prior employer went out of business and all the employees were laid off. That change was a particularly trying time for us, but God was incredibly faithful to us. And in the end, I got a better job that was closer to home and our children's daycare, and it really turned out to be a positive change in our lives. I participate with two different ministries here at the Vineyard, and I've often felt like I'd like to do more, maybe something in the missions area, but I spend about 60% of my waking hours on a weekly basis at work, so adding another activity just seemed like it would be stretching myself way too thin. And as I've grown in my own relationship with God, I just really feel that He's been calling me to think of the people that I work with as my own personal mission area. And to just be where He planted me and to show God's love to people in a very real and practical way on a daily basis. For the last 10 years, I have been leading a group that works with payroll and benefits for about 2,500 employees here in the Virginia area. And that type of work is helping people arrange insurance, manage life changes. Some of them are happy, like having a baby. Some are very sad, like having a divorce. There are folks that need to plan for the future and at times recover from devastating losses. I've worked with employees who have had house fires, the death of a spouse, a number of things that can be at times quite overwhelming. Yet, at times I really felt that God was even calling me to go beyond what I could do as a company representative and to show caring and love for other people in a way that was just between me and the employee and not part of my job. Some of those examples include a coworker sharing with me that she had not had a meal in a week. And so I got her some groceries and prayed with her and told her about the food pantry here at Vineyard. In another example, a single mom was telling me that she really didn't know how she was going to pull together Christmas for her teenage boys. And so I went home and talked with the family, and we packed up our own gaming system, the remotes, the games, everything, We found the original boxes, we packed it all up, and, you know, blessed the family with that so that they could have a good holiday. In another example, an employee had a motorcycle accident outside of work and became paralyzed. But through the skills that I had and the knowledge that I had, I was able to find donated medical equipment for him so that his insurance money could stretch even further. In all of these things, although they were really heartbreaking stories, there was a certain kind of joy that I felt because I knew that I was doing what God wanted me to do in the place that He had arranged just especially for me. The greatest challenge God has ever given me to do at work, though, has been leading people over the last 3 years through my current company going through transformation. And that work involves helping people prepare for and search for other jobs in the company. Some people are successful and some people had to separate. And so, you know, learning to, you know, work with them and to treat them with respect and caring no matter what the outcome was a challenge because I knew all the way that at the end of that three-year journey, my own job would end. And very often people would ask me, you know, how are you doing? And, you know, their job's going up, aren't you going to apply for them? But I really felt that I needed to see that process through and that it would all be okay in the end, that God had a plan for me and I really didn't need to worry and I could be confident that things would turn out okay for me personally, for my family, because God had done that for us before when it happened when my old company went out of business. And, you know, it did offer an opportunity at times to pray with people and I would share with them the verse that I really leaned on a lot and I would share with them. Comes from Jeremiah 29, verse 11. For I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope.
Great story, huh? There's problems out there. She went above and beyond. She wasn't required to do, I don't think, any of that. Looking for ways to be Jesus's hands, Jesus's feet. And so you can expect problems, no doubt about it. You can expect all kinds of problems, angry customers and rambunctious students and patients that won't, you know, are upset at you and computers that are crashing, all kinds of things. And we are problem solvers. Look at this. Jesus says, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. Why? Well, he says, each day has enough trouble of its own. So which days have trouble? Every day, right? Each day. And how much trouble? Enough. I don't need any more. That's enough. And so it's trouble today and trouble tomorrow. Right? Turn to the person next to you. Say, trouble today, trouble tomorrow. You can go to the bank with that. There's going to be trouble. You looking for trouble? I am. I'm looking for trouble. Because I am an ambassador of Christ. Number 7, embrace your real workplace today over imaginary work tomorrow. Real work, despite how humbling your work is, despite how difficult your work is, that is better than this amazing job, this imaginary, grandiose, marvelous, success-driven job that you're going to get. No, you just embrace where you're at. Ecclesiastes says, whatever turns up, grab it and do it heartily. This is your last and only chance at it, for there is neither work to do nor thoughts to think in the company of the dead, where you're most certainly headed, by the way. That's a cheery little thought, right? Ecclesiastes, he needed some Prozac when he was writing that. You say, well, Andy, what if I dislike my job? What if I hate my job? Well, if you hate your job, which is actually more and more common nowadays, if you really dislike your job, the best advice I can give, the best thing when I look over the Bible and look over the scriptures is to treat your job like Jesus would treat it. You treat it like Jesus would treat it. You say, well, I'm not sure it fits my skill set, my aptitude, my gift set. Well, you know, there maybe you can find another match at some point, but you know, in the Jesus's day, you learn the trades of your parents. It didn't matter. You didn't take some, you know, gift assessment Well, you know, I'm not meant to be a fisherman. I mean, you just learn the trades of your, and then you learn to just project your very best person into that. That is what, and you know, by the way, if you do that, if you treat your job like Jesus would treat it, if he was a plumber, if he was a teacher, if he was worked on the base or wherever, that is the best way to get promoted or to start to really like your job. And so you just change, it's an attitude change is what it is. It's almost never just, is this the right job for me? The question is almost always, am I bringing my best to the job? That's almost always the situation. Jobs will change. Jobs will, all kinds of things happen. And things are always shifting out there. We need to be giving our very best. Notice what Paul says here. He says, always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. What is your labor in the Lord? It's what you're doing. It's when you're working for the Lord that you're laboring in the Lord. You see, well, how do I bring Jesus to my workspace, my job? Well, here's what the Bible teaches. Jesus is already there. He's already there. He's already at work. That's why we want to look for signs of the kingdom of God. Jesus said to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're to be looking for signs of what God's doing. And whatever the Father's doing, we want to be doing the same thing. We want to get, and so you look for that. God's already there at work, though. He's already at work, working in people in those circumstances. And so you don't just say, well, how do I bring Jesus? He's there. Let's partner with him. And here's one last thing, and then we'll close. God is highly committed to your spiritual formation. Your spiritual formation. For you to grow more like Christ. For you to grow more like he designed you to be. And his primary way of doing it is in the workplace. It's not in your small group. It's not at church. It's not in your devotions in the morning or at night or whenever you do them. It's in the workplace. It's in the workplace. You get your instructions at church or a small group or in devotions. You get encouraged. We come together and we rally together. Let's go do it. But then we get our spiritual formation happens there. Let me give you an illustration. In the Old Testament, when Solomon's temple was being built, all of the stones that made up the temple, they were formed off-site, somewhere else, in the workplace. Notice, he says, in building the temple, only blocks dressed at the quarry were used. And no hammer, chisel, or any other iron tool was heard at the temple site while it was being built. That's where God chisels us and forms our character. He's forming, because Peter says that we're living stones in the temple of our God. We're living stones. But our formation happens off-site. It happens at our workplace. That's where he's chiseling you. That's where he's forming you. And so the more we resist that, we're resisting what God wants to do in our life. So you got to realize God's going to use my workplace for my benefit. Certainly, as we talked about, work is expending energy for the value of others, creating value. But the greatest thing he does is in me. He changes me. He works on me. I become more like him. You know, one of the things I love about over the many years, 23 years here at the Vineyard, that we have employers in our church that have hired many people in our church. We have people that outside our church, some of them, they say, I don't really believe everything that the Vineyard says, but I love their workers because when we hire Vineyard employees, when we hire people from Vineyard, man, they work hard. They're honest. They're people of integrity. They have a great attitude. That's terrific. That's great. Can you imagine the church that gets it? Imagine, you know, a church that each day they realize that today is their opportunity to go and be somebody that will bring self-initiative and creativity and add value to their company or to their business. And they're bringing their very best. And so not only does it impact you, but everybody else, when they experience that, they get up and they go, thank God it's Monday. And it's because of the influence that we get to we get to impact people with. Let's bow our heads and pray. Well, Lord, I do thank you for work. And I know that work can be very displeasing, it can drain us. Some of you may be working for a wonderful boss. Some of you might have, you're working with Attila the Hun. And you're going, I can't stand it. It's terrible. It's demeaning. Well, they may try to put that on you. But God says that that's on them, that no work is demeaning. If it's work, it's not demeaning. It's dignifying. And so this morning, I would just encourage you to say, I can control myself. I'm going to change my attitude. And so beginning today, would you say, God, I want to thank you for work. Thank you for my job. Thank you that I have a chance to make love visible. And Jesus has a word for you. Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and yoke up with him. He's saying, never do it alone. Don't forget that. Would you say, God, help me? When I'm in a difficult spot, remember, it's not just me and the pipe, me and the computer, me and the angry customer. Remember, help me to remember, it's me and you, Lord. You say, God, help me not to compare myself with others. That's not a very emotionally enhancing experience to get in that cycle of envy. Help me, God, to look for ways I can see your hand already at work, evidence of the kingdom of God at work in my place of employment. And help me to embrace the spiritual formation that you want to do in my life through my work. I thought it was just some mean person. I thought it was something else, but it was really a chisel teaching me patience, teaching me to have joy despite my circumstances, teaching me to learn how to love, not just love people who love me back, but how I can love those who are not very lovable, teaching me self-control, teaching me these things. You're teaching me. You say, God, help me not to resist the chisel, to not be defensive. If you've never asked Christ into your life, why not do that? Say, Jesus Christ, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Right now, where you're at, just say, thank you for dying on your cross for me. I want to put my faith in you. I want to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen.